We're helping creative industries in Devon to become more sustainable in a number of different ways. Through the Green Maker Initiative, which we've begun with Make Southwest, which invites makers across the Southwest to reduce their environmental impact. We ask them to sign a pledge to say they'd like to do that, and then we support them by providing a range of different resources, networking opportunities, events, and today is the Green Maker Initiative event at Make Southwest, where there's a range of activities.
The Green Maker Initiative was set up through our Arts Council project grant, and we are here to support Southwest creatives dedicated to reducing their environmental impact within their creative practice. By joining the Green Maker Initiative, they sign a pledge which gives them a whole list of instructions to help them through their practice and their studio. They sign up, they get a badge, and the badge is made by an organisation called Precious Plastics, which is based in Plymouth in Devon. And then we have this amazing website which is full of useful resources, videos, handouts, all sorts. And then we have events like we have here today at Make Southwest, which was the first Green Maker Initiative launch.
So makers across the Southwest can benefit from the Green Maker Initiative by learning how to reduce their environmental impact. But they can also share their knowledge. For example, they may be a ceramicist and use a particular kiln or use a particular method which helps to reduce energy or water use, for example, and share that with others. But they can benefit in other ways as well through the materials exchange. So they can share their unwanted materials and benefit from someone else's materials which is useful for them. They also get to use the logo, the Green Maker Initiative logo, designed by two graduate 3D design students from University of Plymouth, Oscar McNaughton and Ian Coxall. And this beautiful logo can be put on makers' own publicity, so they can tell other people about how they're reducing their environmental impact and also spread the message about why doing that is important.
I'm reducing my environmental impact by using recycled silver and gold. The filings, my jewellery bench, I keep and I put them in a lemon pot, and I use a company that recycles the lemon, but it also recycles all the cloths, all the wipes I've used, all the sandpaper, all the saw blades. They collect everything, and then when I've got a great big amount of it, they actually search for the silver and melt it down, and then they give me the silver back.
So I'm trying to reduce the environmental impact of my work by first of all by reusing the wax, so steaming out and melting it out of the molds and then reusing it. And then I'm also, once I've made my molds, they're single use molds. So the mold material comes off and I reuse that mold material in my fresh molds. So I reuse a third of that in fresh molds so that I'm not putting so much into landfill. I also am quite conscious of the materials I use with the glass. So I use 100% recycled cotton and then also hemp cord. So the 100% recycled cotton doesn't go to landfill, and the hemp cord is like a much more sustainable material to grow comparatively to cotton in the first place. I also have just started, or I have been trying to reuse glass as well.
I'm involved in all sorts of textiles, but mainly natural dyeing. I try to use as little as water as possible, and I try to use as little heat as possible, because if you use thyme and a naturally occurring source of heat, then that solves two of your problems. And these solar jars are made up with I put what I want to dye in it. I put some little bits of dye in. They're in a clear glass jars. I seal it up and leave it on a sunny windowsill for you know, in high summer, perhaps 8 weeks, and other times of the year, 10, 12 weeks.
Start with you on a green energy tariff. We have an outdoor event space that's all done with solar panels. We compost all our waste product, all our sawdust. So we do recycling. But we are in the phase of looking more at our sustainability. So we are going into basically all our suppliers' routes. So where does our toilet paper come from? Yeah, it's recycled, but it's turning up in plastic. So let's change provider. What are our screws? What are our glues? Just trying to uncover every part of our process.
So in terms of reducing environmental impact, looking at things like not using the kilns as often, making sure they're fully loaded, or if I don't have enough to fill a kiln myself, sharing them with other people so that we're not wasting by putting on like more kilns than we need to. As well as sort of trying to use as much waste as possible within, so even if it's simple things like the leaves and anything that I know from a fact before it goes in the kiln won't survive, recycle it before it goes in rather than fire it and waste the material.
The Green Maker Initiative helps people to reduce their environmental impact by encouraging them to monitor, manage and reduce what they're doing. So this can be around the way that they source materials. So they're encouraged to think about what is the provenance of those materials, where have they come from, how are they produced in their work.
Flax is a really amazing plant. It has all kinds of amazing properties. It's the strongest of the vegetable fibres. One of the main reasons I wanted to grow my own flax and produce my own linen was to try and take control of the supply chain that I was involved in for me. So I'm trying to grow the flax and produce a commercially viable cloth from it so that I can sell it to other people. And that would be a completely local, small circle of production.
I'm a felt maker, but my practice is making shrouds and things related to funerals. So the wool is two sources, basically. It's either organic, the white stuff, just a sort of general organic bale of wool, and the coloured wool is from two specific farms which practice looking after the soil. So for me, it's about provenance and also, you know, welfare for the sheep and welfare for the environment as well. I can't just make stuff. I have to know what it's made of and what life that has and what will happen to it when it has no use anymore. So for me, it's very much about knowing its ecology, the ecology of the material that I'm using.
I think working with byproducts and reusing materials. So I wire some of these, but I try and use reclaim wire because there's heaps of it. I mean, you can use fencing wire if you wanted. And I mean, places like the dump, charity shops, boot sales, junk shops, there's really no reason to source all these things new. Buying secondhand in all things across your life is the first major step everyone can make, because you'll also find better quality for less. That's what I've found. I couldn't afford most of the things I own new, but I found them because somebody didn't want them. And you can find so many amazing things.
We go along to textiles fairs and we buy remnant fabrics to use within our making. Otherwise that may well end up in landfill.
So I forge buckles from shipwrecked metal and handcraft leather goods. So it's all hand-stitched. So the metal is salvaged metal from Devon and Cornish shipwrecks. One predominantly is the Second World War American Liberty ship. And it's wrought iron pins that were destined for the front lines. They were part of the cargo on board the ship. So they're just strewn across the seabed And they come back to me in great lumps of concretion. So I remove the concretion and then it exposes the pins, wartime pins, in various states of erosion. And then that's when I forge it into the buckles. I incorporate as much used materials in my work as I possibly can.
The Green Maker Initiative asks them to think about energy. Where does their energy come from? How much energy are they using? And is it possible to reduce that? And to think about waste, what waste is generated, how waste can be repurposed, and think about packaging, for example, what's the nature of the packaging. The Green Maker Initiative helps to connect people by telling each other that they're involved in the Green Maker Initiative. So on the Make Southwest website, there is a specific Green Maker Initiative area. Every member of the Green Maker Initiative has their name listed, their website for their business if they wish, and they get to network with others by attending events as well. So they get to meet in person if they want to, and also meet online at a series of online events that we have, which is all about sharing information, expert speakers. So there are a number of ways that makers get to connect with each other.
How I'm attempting to reduce my impact environmentally is I source all my equipment secondhand, if possible, and locally. Rather than importing things, I'm choosing to make them myself and design them myself. And I tend to use either reclaimed or recycled glass wherever possible, and to minimalise my use of new production glass. And one of my main things is life cycle thinking. When I think about something from when the energy that goes into mining it, transporting it, and the potential impacts of that, and minimalizing the use of precious metals. So I do something which is called fuming, which is using a nano-thin layer of silver over glass. So it appears to be quite colourful and beautiful, but it's in fact only a few microns thick of silver. And also thinking about things at the end of their life cycle. Anything that I make can potentially come back to me and be repaired or crafted into something new if it's got significance for the owner.
For me, the Green Maker Initiative was a no-brainer, really. It was an automatic kind of thing to join and to see what, you know, what other people are doing as well. So it's connecting with other makers as well.
As an associate professor of design, what's really important when we talk to our students is not only what they're designing, it's about what they're making, how they're producing, and actually what their sustainable impact is. So what that means in real terms is we don't want more stuff for the sake of more stuff. So therefore, it's really important to think about who is your user, why they may want this thing, whatever this may be, and then of course what the whole process is to make it.
My practice is very much focused about designing with sustainable living to promote that. For example, the product that I've got here, or this is one part of the product, which is a pestle and mortar system for the kitchen, which is around healthy food and but really wonderful sensory experiences. And that's supported by an app that gives the craft makers the ability to use their own local materials and promote themselves to consumers and also share resources. And it gives the consumer then an idea as well about the product's carbon footprint.
I'm on the MA Design Programme at the University of Plymouth. My practice specialist is in relationships, those we have with objects, with people, with each other, and society. I'm particularly interested in the relationships between traditional craft and contemporary technology. I'm also on the team at Precious Plastics Plymouth and Tavistock, where I've been making a bike shredder for them to use in partnership with the University of Plymouth. And that's funded by Marine Litter Research Group, along with Project Indigo. And we've been working to shred plastic into new things. So we make a whole range of products at Precious Plastics. We've been making soap dishes, pots and buttons. We've also working on, we've got a new CNC machine, so we're looking to work with groups in the communities and businesses in Plymouth to allow them to make products then with us out of recycled plastics.
By joining together in a movement, we can share information and education. We can teach, you know, best practice. And I think it's information sharing and connecting with other people so that we can collaborate, you know, which is what I love doing.
I'm interested in the Green Maker Initiative, really because I feel like every industry has a responsibility to be environmental, and the art industry is no exception.
I'm interested in the Green Maker Initiative in terms of engaging in a larger movement. So it's, we're not just woodworkers, it's all things encompassing the woodland and various crafts. For us, it's the networking and also being able to sort of be part of the pledge that the Green Maker is making.
So I'm very keen to do all I can as an individual to reduce my carbon footprint and promote practices that reduce the carbon footprint and help to alleviate the climate change emergency.
So I joined the Green Maker Initiative because I think it's a really good network to be a part of, and I'm trying to do my part, and I'd like to know what other makers are doing and if there's ways that I can improve what I'm doing and see, like, collectively what we can do together, because it could be that some of my waste could be used by someone else, or it might be that there's a material that someone else uses that I'm really interested in using in my work. And I think as a group, as a collective, we have more power than individually, so that's why I've joined Greenmaker.
I'm a member of the Green Maker Initiative because it's going to make me think even more about my practice. I think most of it is quite sustainable at the moment, but I think I can go the extra mile and make it even more so.